I'm Donna Gilmore. I'm the founder of the San Onofre safety.org website. A few months before Fukushima, I was sitting in my backyard in San Clemente and oblivious to all what was going on. And I read in the local paper that employees at the plant were being fired for reporting safety problems. So after investigating, I found out not only was that happening, but we don't have a lot of time, so I'll cut to this. San Onofre has more safety complaints from employees to the Nuclear Regulatory Commission than any other plant in the entire nation. You can see the red lines over there is San Onofre, and that's all the rest of them, you know, the blue lines for the rest of the plants. And they also have the highest rate of retaliating against employees that report safety problems. Okay. And this data comes directly from the Nuclear Regulatory Commission website. One of the whistleblowers showed me how to read their, what they call, safety allegation statistics. And this is like a six-year period, and it continues today. And then there's a chart for their steam generators that looks pretty similar to this. They have like the worst steam generators too. So, but that's a whole nother, we need another day for that. And now we're relying on Southern California Edison to manage the tons of waste that's sitting at the plant. After the plant closed, I started researching the waste. And what I found out is, I didn't think I could be shocked anymore, San Onofre chose to use a fuel that is over twice as radioactive and unstable in storage and unpredictable. It's going to take at least 15 years to cool in the what they call spent fuel pools before it's cool enough to move to a dry container. However, I also learned that even the NRC will not approve a container, a dry cask, for this what they call high burnup fuel, because it burns longer in the reactor, because they don't trust it will last longer than 20 years in the dry container. This stuff is this high burnup fuel. It's a fuel that can burn longer in the reactor, which makes Edison more money but makes us less safe. It's breaking the protective cladding around the uranium pellets. It's cracking, and if that cracks, it can release radiation into the environment. And if any oxygen gets in those dry containers, we can have a hydrogen explosion in a dry cask down there. And we've got, how many more times of than Chernobyl?
The amount of radiation that we've stored 19 times the amount of radiation that was released in Chernobyl accident right here in San Onofre.
Yeah, and there's no, so people are wanting to get this stuff out of here. Well, the Nuclear Regulatory Commission will not approve a transportation container because the protective cladding over the uranium is becoming fragile, and it might shatter if they move the stuff. So we're kind of stuck. So what is the nuclear industry? What is San Onofre? What is the NRC doing about this? Not much. They're not doing anything that's going to help. So I collaborated with a nuclear physicist, and we put together a paper on the problem in more details, and we have some suggestions for what we can do to improve this. But from what I've learned in all my research is we're in an environment where profit is prioritized over safety, and this, you know, goes all the way up. So unless we get citizen involvement to flip that, so we have safety over profits, you know, we're going to be the next Fukushima, even though those reactors are not running. It's that serious. It's a question?
Yes. You mentioned this high burnup fuel.
High burnup fuel.
How is that different than a
Well, MOCs can be high burnout. MOCs is very dangerous also. They're not using that at the plant. A high burnout fuel is low enriched uranium. They take the uranium and they add up to 5% of uranium-235 to it. And by doing that, you can use the fuel longer. You can burn it longer in the reactor before you have to take it out and treat it as spent fuel. MOX has plutonium in it.
Yes.
Okay, so that's the difference. That's extremely dangerous. No, but it eventually will create plutonium at some point. So now, there's a technical term they use. The NRC currently defines high burnup is fuel that has produced, what is it, over 45 gigawatt days per metric ton of uranium. Anyway, so it's a, you know, kind of a convoluted measurement. But in actuality, the Department of Energy has reports that fuel that has burn up as low as 30 gigawatt days is showing the same signs. And the fuel at San Onofre, it's all pretty much over 40 is what they have there, except for this stuff that just recently came out of Unit 2 that they had loaded in anticipating of restarting, and they didn't get to do that. Question? Yes, you can actually, I've kind of got it set up so you can either read the cliff notes or the long version, okay? So if you go to the homepage, sanonofresafety.org, it'll give you the highlights of not only this issue, but a number of other really important issues. And then you can, and I actually have a nuclear waste page that goes into this and a number of other things that, you know, they're, you know, it's kind of late and I don't want to wear people out, but this is a critical issue, and I've found myself in an odd situation that I'm actually educating nuclear engineers on this. They were misled, let's say, years ago that the only difference between high burnup fuel and lower burnup fuel was it just has to cool longer before you can put it in dry cask, and that's not true. And they knew it wasn't true, but for some reason they didn't understand that. So every document on my website has links to either an NRC document or a government or scientific report backing up all the facts that I have. And I've got copies of the NRC document where they're not approving more than 20 years of dry storage, where they're not approving transportation studies and charts. There's a chart showing the higher the burnup, the more hydrides get created, and the more hydrides, you know, the higher the risk of a hydrogen explosion like you saw at Fukushima. And if any oxygen gets to that, and those canisters that they put it in, they're made out of stainless steel, and there's a worker at the plant that used to run the shop that manufactured those, and he says this marine environment, well, you know what it does to metals, we live here, it, you know, is affecting the metals and affecting the welds. So if that containment is breached in the canister and the cladding has failed, then those casks will just explode right there, and that radiation will go everywhere. So it's very important to get involved in. Question?
So you all know about Dr. Helen Caldicott?
Yes, I know about Helen Caldicott.
She's the
on high burnup?
On nuclear reactors.
Oh, on nuclear reactors. Yeah,
all,
yeah,
all
yeah.
The
okay.
So
she's. Yeah, she is, and it's important to share this information and to learn more. The report that was done with Dr. Marvin Reznikoff, that's been presented to the head of the Nuclear Regulatory Commission, to some Senate staff. So we've got some different action items going and some recommendations. The industry, their idea of solving the problems is, let's stick some high burnup fuel in a canister that was not even approved for it, and we'll just watch and prove to you that everything's hunky-dory, and that's their plan. That's the plan.
So they have no other plan for long-term storage?
Well, and the other problem is they don't even consider options if it's going to cost them too much money. So that's the other thing that has to change, but that's not going to change without, you know, pressure from people here and other places. I've also found that the people that are in power that can do something about this are totally ignorant of this issue. I spoke to the CPUC Commissioner Florio. He'd never heard the term high burnup. PG&E tried to lie about it and got caught. I read their document and now San Onofre is trying to approve a new model dry cast that's even going to be more dangerous to put it in. So we can't trust them to do it right. We can't trust the NRC to watch it. So we need something similar to what we did to get San Onofre shut down. Now we had to get San Onofre shut down, we had Friends of the Earth involved. They had a generous donation from somebody in Laguna Beach. So we need to thank whoever that was in Laguna Beach for making the difference, because if there was no money to pay for those lawyers to take legal action against our own government, that plant may have restarted. So it took a team effort, and then we went to local city councils, we educated city councils, we educated state level, we educated Barbara Boxer. And so through this process, putting it all together, the plant was shut down. But without the money for the lawyers, you know, wouldn't have happened. I recommend that you go to the website and get educated. If you follow it, I don't do many postings on it because I know everybody's busy and they have a lot of other things to do. So if there's something significant event, it'll get posted there. And Gary also has a list where he'll send things out for events with his San Clemente Green. So you can sign up and get those. It's not a whole lot of emails. It's just significant things. But it's important, you know, you care enough to show up. How many of you knew that San Onofre had the worst safety record? Quite a few. Okay, so that's good. So we're counting on them, and they're not going to do it. So it's up to us. We've got another big battle here, and I'm going to be optimistic. It's winnable, but at the same time, I'm not going to remodel my house yet. So.